To essential electric. So in today's lecture we are going to discuss about the choice of the conductor. So first we will discuss about the properties that a conductor should possess, and then we'll discuss what are the different conductors that we are using in an electrical power transmission line, and then at the end of the session we will discuss about the spacing between the conductors. So let's say the conductor which is used for transmission as well as distribution purpose, that should have certain properties. Now when we talk about the properties, the first property that a conductor should have, low resistivity, or we can say high amount of conductivity in order to carry more power, okay, or we can say the more amount of current. The second property that a conductor should possess is it should have high mechanical strength, or we can say the tensile strength to withstand heavy mechanical load. Because in certain cases, they should have to be ready for ice storm, they should have to be ready for the wind condition. Okay, so your mechanical strength of your conductor should be as high as possible. The third is it should be corrosion free. The fourth, it should be light in weight. Obviously, it should be light in weight. Otherwise, if the weight of the conductor is more, in that case, we need more heavy structure of your towers. Okay, and that will be not economical. So the fifth criteria, which is minimum voltage drop and power loss, is minimum. So if your voltage drop is minimum, in that case we will have high receiving end voltage. In that case our voltage regulation can be improved. In case of low power loss or minimum power loss, our transmission efficiency can be improved. So when we talk about the performance of transmission line, then efficiency and voltage regulation is the main criteria, and to improve your voltage regulation and transmission efficiency, your voltage drop and power loss should be as minimum as possible. The sixth property, it should be cheap. Obviously your conductor should be as economical as possible. And the seventh is it should be flexible. So these are certain properties that your conductor should possess, and in view of this requirement, these are the following materials are generally used for the conductors. The first is a copper conductor, the second is aluminium conductor, the third is SESR conductor, and fourth is galvanized steel. Now we are going to deal with copper, aluminium, SESR and galvanized steel in detail. So let us start with copper conductor. So a hard drawn bar copper, or we can say HDBC, is most widely used material as a conductor in case of transmission as well as distribution system, or we can say in case of overhead transmission line, or in case of underground cables too. Okay, so this is due to because its conductivity is very high. The second property which a conductor should possess and copper is possessing is it has high resistance against corrosion, and it has high current density, and the conductor is homogeneous. So these are certain advantage of having copper conductor. Now there are few drawbacks of using copper conductor, and the only negative point is that it is very costly, and this is the reason that it is being replaced by aluminium conductor. So aluminium is, we can say, the next best conducting material after copper conductor for the use of transmission as well as distribution system. Now if we talk about the conductivity of aluminium, so is less than obviously copper, so conductivity of aluminium is 2/3 time of conductivity of copper conductor. But when we talk about the weight, so aluminium conductor is lighter in weight than copper. So the weight of aluminium conductor is 1/3 of the weight of copper conductor. So therefore, a large cross section of aluminium conductor with compared to copper conductor is required for the same amount of current to flow. Okay, so therefore it needs higher towers. It is more affected by the sag due to the weak mechanical strength. So aluminium conductor, we can say the length of span is also reduced, and obviously we know the cost of aluminium conductor is less compared to copper conductors. Okay, So next thing is ACSR conductor, and ACSR it stands for aluminium conductor with steel reinforced. Now if you look at your construction of your ACSR conductor, it has core of galvanized steel and it is usually used to prevent against the corrosion which is surrounded by the aluminium strands. So here you can see in the figure that your steel strands are surrounded by the aluminium strands. Now here the application of steel and aluminium is given that steel take care of your mechanical stress and aluminium take care of the heavy current. Okay, so due to the high mechanical strength of steel, the sag in case of ACSR conductor is very small. Okay, so that is why steel is used, because your sag is very small, because the tensile strength, or we can say mechanical strength of steel, is very high. So therefore larger span can be used. And in case of ACSR conductor, one drawback is that skin effect is appreciable in case of ACSR conductor. Okay, so this is one of the disadvantage of using ACSR conductor. Otherwise there are so many advantages of using ACSR. Last but not the least, fourth, which is galvanized steel. Now due to the very high tensile strength of galvanized steel, it can be extremely used for large span. If we talk about the galvanized steel, because of the galvanization process, it protects against corrosion. So it is one of the advantage. There are more in use of your, we can say, small power or small distance. So in case of rural application where the cost is main consideration, galvanized steel is more useful. Now these kind of conductors is also used as earth wire on the poles, as stay wires on all other similar application. Okay, so basically main application of galvanized steel is as a earth wire. Okay, so based on this much of discussion, we can say that the different types of conductors are used on the transmission line, which is depends on the voltage class, and the second thing is amount of current to be handled. Okay, so main criteria for selection, the type of the conductor is voltage class, I mean the how much the voltage level is there, and the amount of current to be handled. So if we talk about India, it is standard practice to use the following conductors for the different voltage level. So in case of 66 kV, we are using ACSR DOC conductor. All are the types of ACSR conductors. Okay, so in case of 66 kV, ACSR DOC conductor is used. In case of 66 or 132 kV, ACSR Panther conductors are used. In case of 220 kV, Zebra, and 400 kV, ACSR twin bundle Moose conductors are generally used. Okay, so based on whatever the voltage level is there and amount of current to be flow through the transmission line, we are going to select the conductor. Okay, once the conductor is selected, now the main consideration or the second criteria is the spacing between the conductor. Because if the spacing between the conductor is too less, then we have to face the problem related to corona. If the spacing between the conductor is too more, in that case we need more longer cross arm. Okay, that is not economical, because the cost of tower is going to be we can say increase. Okay, so spacing between the conductor is one major thing that we have to consider. So most suitable spacing and arrangement for over a transmission line conductors cannot be determined mathematically. Okay, so it is decided by the empirical formula. Now what do you mean by empirical formula? When I say empirical formula, I mean that it is not the formula that is derived by the mathematical procedure. Okay, but when I say empirical formula, it means it can be derived by the thousands of experiments, real experiments. So the spacing between the conductor is also a kind of formula that can be done by doing number of experiments. Okay, so a German empirical formula, it is used for the spacing of aluminium conductor, which is given by spacing is equal to square root of D plus V divided by 150 meter. Okay, here D is the sag in meter at 40 degree centigrade, and here V is voltage in kilovolt. Okay, so using this formula we are going to derive the spacing between two conductors. So if we have, let's say, 11 kV transmission line, okay, and we have the value of sag, if you put this value into this root D and V, you will get the spacing for 11 kV transmission line. Okay, so the spacing arrangement may be horizontal, it can be vertical, it can be equilateral, triangular fashion. Okay, so it depends on the circumstances around the transmission line. So in area where the snowfall is very much higher, so the horizontal configuration of conductor is more suitable. Okay, so in that way we are going to do this, we can say, arrangement of your conductors. Okay, so the approximate equivalent spacing of the transmission line that is given right here. So let's say in case of 11 kV transmission line, your equivalent spacing is 1 meter. In case of 33, it is 1.3. In 66, it is 2.6 and so on. Okay, so the relationship between the equivalent spacing between the conductors in meter and a line-to-line voltage in kV, if you plot the graph, then it will go something like this. Okay, so here you can see when my transmission line voltage increases, at the same time my equivalent spacing between conductor is also increases. Okay, so they are in this proportion. So this is how you select the conductor, and I hope you understand how you can choose that the spacing between the conductors. So I hope you understand each and everything that we have discussed in today's lecture. If you have any doubt, feel free to contact in case of any query. And if you follow this me in this PSPD subject or follow me any of my course, then feel free to subscribe my channel. Thank you so much. See you guys next time.